and have an ad hoc committee put in place to tackle the problem of copyrights in the country. The decision was by the Prime Minister, Head of Government, Philemon Yang. And also in this newscast, we take you to Cairo, Egypt, where Mohamed Morsi has been slammed a 20-year jail term by an Egyptian court. The details of these headlines and more in just a moment. Good evening to you televiewers. We thank you so much for joining us in this edition of the 6 p.m. newscast on Equinox Television. Traders in Ancien Troisième at the Congo market here in the economic capital Douala today succeeded to contain a fire outbreak which emanated from a cable as a result of high voltage. The incident that caused panic this morning left traders worried about the anarchical connection of cables in the said market. Mfohansen Changiworth was there and brought back the following report.
Early Tuesday, Ancien Troisième Congo market in Douala, economic capital. As traders are busy opening their shops, high voltage causes fire to spark from cables. To avoid being victims of another fire incident, traders at the Congo market, especially those selling mobile phones and accessories, mobilized and contained the fire before the arrival of firefighters.
Très tôt ce matin, comme nous ouvrons les boutiques, apparemment les fils qui sont...
Very early this morning, while opening our stores, the cables you see up there started exploding, especially those that are poorly connected. It was as a result of high tension. Flames could be seen coming out. Fortunately, some traders used sand to put off the fire before the arrival of the firefighting brigade. I think that poor connection and poor quality of cables could be the reason for the outbreak.
Bon, c'est vrai, les gens, les sapeurs sont venus bien après, mais nous, on avait éteint le feu.
Just like other markets in Douala, which has been visited by fire this year, the Congo market could be next. In any case of fire outbreak, cables are of poor quality and anarchically connected. Cables could be seen crisscrossing buildings and shops at the market. Traders at the Congo market are calling on local government authorities to reinstall all connections at the market.
And an ad hoc committee, as we announced in the headlines, has been created by the Prime Minister, Head of Government, to analyze and propose concrete solutions to that can end the crisis rocking the copyright sector in the country. Philemon Yang has given the committee 15 days to deliver its findings. Mfohansen Changi once again has the details.
Cameroon's head of government, Philemon Yang, wants to put an end to the imbroglio existing at Cameroon's Authors' Rights Association. An ad hoc committee has to this effect been put in place to analyze the crisis rocking the body and propose concrete solutions. Joe Mbule, former member of SOCAM Normalization Committee, thinks that the action of PM Yang is timely. According to him, musicians cannot solve their problems without the guidance of the administration. But the ad hoc committee, according to Joe Mbule, has a daunting task, that of regrouping all actors and make them understand that together they will stand and divided they will fall. The house therefore needs to be clean, personal interests put aside for the growth and proper follow-up of authors' rights in Cameroon.
Tout ce que j'entends parler, c'est des gens qui veulent des postes au conseil d'administration.
The ad hoc committee put in place by PM Yang is a clear indication that Amatutu Muna's normalization committee has been sleeping, created in 2014 to normalize the country's copyright sector, but their work has never been made public. To right the wrong, therefore, Yang's ad hoc committee has 15 days to put concrete solutions on the table. The ad hoc committee comprises of a president from the general secretary of the prime minister's office, members from the PM's office representing the culture, communication, sports, public and administrative affairs divisions, two representatives from the Ministry of Arts and Culture, one representative from Ministry of Justice, Ministry of Territorial Administration and Decentralization, Defense, National Security, four representatives from syndicate, one representative from personnel of SOCAM.
And a new general manager has been appointed to head the country's postal service company, that is Compost. The man to replace A.V. Beryl was appointed during an extraordinary meeting of board of directors of Compost, which took place in the nation's capital, Yaoundé. Today, we shall be bringing you updates in a subsequent newscast. Out of Cameroon, an Egyptian court has sentenced Mohamed Morsi to 20 years in jail for ordering the arrest and torture of protesters during his rule. It is the first verdict he received since he was deposed as president. A majority of the other defendants were also given 20-year prison sentences. Morsi's legal team has so far vowed to appeal the verdict. He was deposed by the military in July 2013 following mass street protests against his rule. And in South Africa, we have an update on what's happening as far as the xenophobic attack, which started several weeks back, is concerned. The South African Defense Minister has said that the South African Army will be deployed to end a wave of attacks on foreigners. Soldiers will be deployed in the main city of Johannesburg and in the KwaZulu-Natal province. This will be the first troop deployment since the violence broke out early this month, killing at least 7 people. 4 suspects appeared in court yesterday who were accused of killing a Mozambican, and they were being remanded into custody without being asked to plead. More than 900 people have voluntarily repatriated back to their home countries since the violence broke out early this month. Police say that the situation is calm now, with no new violent attacks reported anywhere in South Africa. Now, South Africans have been protesting the influx of foreigners since 1994. It's actually a story that dates as far back as 1994. Their major problem is that most posts are being occupied by those foreign nationals, putting the rate of unemployment among South Africans at 25%. Jacques Ekwekenge comes back to the history of xenophobia attack in South Africa.
The media has been awash with reports of xenophobic attacks in South Africa. The latest spate of violence in the country began about 3 weeks ago. The saga apparently started with the speech by Zulu King Goodwill Zwelithini, who last month said that foreigners must pack up and leave the country. Not long after that, reports about attacks by locals on immigrants broke out. The violence have left a number of black immigrants dead, severely injured, and displaced. Reactions have been trailing these recent xenophobic attacks in South Africa from international community and particularly from around the African continent. Zimbabwe's President Robert Mugabe was quoted as saying, "South Africans will kick down a statue of a dead white man, but won't even attempt to slap a live one." Yet they can stone to death a black man simply because he is a foreigner, end of quote. Zimbabweans and Malawian authorities have dispatched buses to transport their citizens from South Africa. Meantime, Zambia's biggest private radio station, Cure FM, has announced on its Facebook page that it has indefinitely blacked out the playing of South African music in protest against xenophobic attacks. In Mozambique, workers at mining and gas companies have also protested about the violence, downing their tools, demanding that South African employees leave and that their jobs be taken over by those fleeing the violence. And in Malawi, there have been calls for people to stop buying South African goods and services, spearheaded by the executive director of the Consumers Association of Malawi. Meantime, in Nigeria, lawmakers of the lower house passed a motion Thursday to recall the Nigerian ambassador to South Africa for consultations over the attacks. The MPs also debated whether to use existing legislation to put pressure on South African businesses in Nigeria if the attacks continue. These reactions and more have continued to pour in from all the nooks and corners of the globe against the xenophobic attacks in South Africa, despite the call to order from South African authorities.
The xenophobic attack there in South Africa has been felt in the entire continent. Now, details have emerged of the capsize of a migrant boat in the Mediterranean last weekend that killed more than 800 Prosecutors in Italy say that the captain, who survived and faces multiple homicide charges, crashed the boat by mistake against a merchant rescue ship. The International Organization for Migration says that deaths in the year 2015 alone are 30 times higher than the same period last year, that is in 2014, and could rise even up to 30,000. Now, the United Nations has equally said that it is the deadliest recorded in the Mediterranean. Let's have the details with the Dutch Velen TV.
Swift and decisive action against human traffickers. That's what EU foreign ministers hope their 10-point plan will deliver if it is adopted later this week. Italian police are already taking action. They've arrested three men accused of smuggling 100 refugees from Turkey to Italy. Arrests have also been made in connection with the drowning deaths of over 800 refugees from Libya on Sunday. Two suspected human traffickers are currently in custody. The 27 surviving victims are recuperating in Sicily. Members of the UN's refugee agency spoke to the survivors of the tragedy.
They were very tired and very traumatized, of course. One of them was taken to the hospitals. The others received medical attention. They had new clothes distributed to them and had some food before being transferred to the reception facility.
The scale of the disaster is unprecedented. The ship set sail from the Libyan capital, Tripoli, on a course for Lampedusa. The boat capsized some 200 kilometers from its destination. Survivors said many passengers were locked below deck and had no chance of saving themselves. Italy urged Europe to focus on stopping the traffickers.
It's no exaggeration to say that we're being confronted by a new form of slavery. Most people would rather not imagine what happened 300 or 400 years ago off the coast of West Africa, as unscrupulous men traded in human lives. Now the same thing is happening off the coast of North Africa.
The tide of refugees making the crossing to southern Europe shows no sign of slowing. This boat with 450 people on board began to sink around 80 nautical miles off the Italian coast. But this time at least, the Italian Coast Guard arrived before it was too late.
And they're bringing us to the end of this edition of the Primetime Newscast on Equinox Television. Viewers, thank you so much for joining us. Until we meet again, goodbye.